That's the cutest thing ever. Yes. Cursing's allowed?
Cursing is allowed.
I've yet to do that. This might get crazy.
It doesn't seem like it's your thing, really. Is there cursing in this? I don't remember anybody cursing in this movie.
No, there's quiet ones. I think we slipped them by. There's Michael McKean says one, and Lucy Punch says one very faintly. But,
yes.
But yeah, no, I curse.
Well, it's hard to get Lucy Punch to not curse.
She should curse.
That's her
thing. Sounds so great in that accent, though.
It's one of her special gifts.
She has many special gifts,
along with making many faces.
She's so funny. Oh, my God.
So how did you gather this group for this this movie? Because it is quite a cast.
Yeah, it's crazy. Different ways. I mean, Susan came on first, and it was a really hard film to get made. Nobody wanted to make a film about a woman of a certain age at that time, so it was really frustrating. After a couple of years, I finally was just home one night and decide I'm writing a letter and I'm sending it to her agent cold and unsolicited, and her agent read it, liked it, gave it to Susan, who read it, liked it, and then we met, and then it was a whole lot easier to get the rest of the cast once she came on board. I mean, people like JK and Rose were right after that, and I think people liked the script, but I think everybody was really excited to work with Susan, and, you know, it was not hard to get people to come out for a day or a two of work to be able to just have some scene work with her. And so, but people came from different places. Gerard Carmichael is a friend of mine who is also just the most talented person ever. His TV show is my favorite thing, and
so I'd like to think you discovered him now, because he had to shoot this before the TV show ever happened. So
he did.
You're ahead of the curve.
Yeah, well, I knew. I mean, I can't say that for sure, because, I mean, his stand-up career is pretty extraordinary, and Spike Lee directed his special for HBO. I mean, he's the real deal, but he's also the voice of his generation. I mean, that show, this show, I'm obsessed with this show. It is my new favorite show. But mostly he was just the most charming man in my living room. So that's how he happened. And other people I was just a fan of and never imagined that I'd get them to come out for smaller roles. Lucy was someone that I had worked with before and know. So, you know, that was someone I randomly ran into and just asked. And so little things here and there, but for the most part, just, you know, just went for it. Just went for the people that I had only dreamed of, and I can't believe how lucky I got.
So, going even further back, what inspired you to write a movie about your mom?
My mom. My mom inspired it. She moved from New Jersey after my dad passed away 6 years ago. Moved here to Los Angeles to be closer to me. And she went. She moved into the Palazzo right behind the Grove. And walked across the street, went to the Apple store, and got a phone, and then just called me all the time and left millions of messages and sent texts and eventually too many emojis. And yeah, I mean, I think she's been a character my whole life that I get such a kick out of her, and she's the most generous person on the planet and so loving and everything, but really, I thought what she did was incredibly brave, moving 3,000 miles away from the house you lived in, really, forever, and starting over in this weird big city, and then we were both grieving in really different ways, and she was grieving very beautifully and optimistically, and I was not grieving quite so beautifully and optimistically, and it was hard, but it also just made me realize I really wanted to tell a story about her and less so about me in a sense. You know, of course, there's the mother-daughter element to it, and Rose is amazing in the film, but even when it was so hard to get this film made, people were trying to get it to be a traditional two-hander and, you know, have the daughter role be as big, and I just thought, well, that's missing the point entirely. Like, this is supposed to be about, you know, taking away what a meddler means and see what they're like on their own and what your mom is doing when you're not calling her back and feel that loneliness and realize that that's where a lot of it comes from. Not, you know, I mean, of course, my mom would be calling anyway and be wanting to dote on me anyway. But with a loss like that, you know, it really is about people moving on. And so, yeah, my mom inspired all of it, really.
So go even further back.
I was born in...
Yes. And what day was it? You've had a major movie made at a studio. You've made this indie film as a director. You've directed some other things.
Yeah.
Where did all that start for you? Was there an acceleration after your father passed and you recovered, or was that just coincidental to the timing of everything?
No. I would say almost nothing's coincidental, but I've been writing screenplays since I was a little kid. Mm. Like, I was a child who liked to write scripts, and I mean, they're scripts, you know. I don't know what they look like. I have saved some. A lot of them it's a lot of action, a lot of stuff I really didn't know anything about, but it's just always been the thing I did. Mm. And even as a little kid, I always loved to imagine scenes and the songs you'd put to scenes, and it just always interested me. And I didn't go to film school, so I thought that I would write my way into the director's chair. And so I was a writer for a long time, and it was pretty unsatisfying in a way. I mean, I loved how Nick and Nora's Infinite Playlist came out. I think Pete Solit's great, and I love all the actors in that film. But it is hard when you write something for a long time, you write it for years, and you hand it off. And so so that was when I set up Seeking a Friend for the End of the World, because with the same company that had done Nick and Nora's, I had a great relationship with them. And so I had sold them it as a pitch with myself attached to direct, which they said they hadn't heard of before.
Sylvester Stallone did that.
Yeah. But no, I think he wrote the script in like 3 days, though, almost sold his dog or something. I mean, he was in worse shape. But I was writing Seeking a Friend when my father was dying and when he died. And so that movie is about dying. I mean, it's a high concept, you know, end of the world romantic comedy in a way. Comedy is, I hate to say, but to me that was a personal story about...
Just explain why they had a hard time selling it.
Yeah, exactly.
Sorry.
It bummed me out how they sold it, obviously. And yet I don't think I gave them an easy sell. So, it was about dying. I mean, I know that it was asking a lot of people to go from like laughing at the surreal nature of things to, you know, expecting them to be on this journey and cry for people. But that for me was what dying was. It was what witnessing dying was like. It's surreal and weird and funny sometimes, and then heartbreaking. And so that was where all that came from. There was no coincidence, but after he died and I had this script, I was more determined than ever to get it made. And I remember telling them, like, the Scafaria women need this. My mother and I need this. And I found out at my grandmother's wake that it was greenlit. It was just a crazy year and a half of a lot of loss and then this surreal, you know, win in getting to make the movie. And but it was an out-of-body experience because, you know, it was almost like too soon. And my mom was on set every day, which was a lot of fun. She brought two chairs in case, you know, anybody needed one. and I sat her at Video Village the whole time, which I really recommend for first-time filmmakers to have your mother at Video Village, because as much as I feared that she was going to get me fired by, like, telling Steve Carell things like, oh, that was so good, I love that take. I also, it allowed producers to have to leave Video Village if they wanted to talk shit or say anything negative. So, you know, kind of broke up a bad environment. And so once that wasn't obviously a big blockbuster or anything, it was you know, a question of how to get back there again. And because that movie was, I was so desperate to make the first one, I didn't know what to fight for, and the answer is everything. You have to fight for everything. But I knew I could make a flawed film or no film, and, you know, I chose to make a flawed film, really. And
and was directing what you knew you were heading? I mean, is it protecting your script, or is it because you really want to direct?
No, I really want to direct. In fact, after seeking a friend, I went and was directing television because I just wanted more time on set, and I just wanted... It's weird how much it's fully replaced writing for me, which used to be the most fulfilling thing in my life, was to be able to do what I love to do any time. And now the thing that I love to do most requires millions of dollars and hundreds of people and, you know, and movie stars and lots of things. So it's changed for me because I'm most at home on a set. You know, my father, he worked in, he had his own business for the last 10 years. He was in the garment business, and he had basically a factory that was, he oversaw lots of different people, you know, sewers and cutters and pressers and I realized only when I was on the set of Seeking a Friend, I was like, oh, this is what he did. You know, I feel like I'm overseeing all these people who are just experts at their own particular thing, and that I get to, you know, look at the big picture and try to, you know, wrangle all the minds together. And, you know, it's become the only thing for me. So I hope to keep writing things and have other people direct them. That would be fine. And I'd love to direct things other people write. But all I really want to do is, you know, the sequel. Another one of these.
Is there a Meddler 2 in you?
No. I mean, no. You know, I like to just leave it as it is. But there's plenty of material. There's plenty of material for a trilogy at this point. But we'll save it.
So I assume that Rose Byrne was just the your casting people were just told to get somebody who looked as much like you as possible.
That's very nice for me and less nice for Rose. But I wanted her from the beginning. People told me we weren't going to be able to get her. You know, I mean, she's the two other movies she's promoting now are Neighbors 2 and X-Men. I mean, we're lucky that we have her. But no, I just fantasized about her because I don't know anyone else who moves through comedy and drama so seamlessly. I've never seen somebody so funny, such unbelievable timing, and then move straight into the most heartbreaking work. You know, I mean, she's really something, and she and Susan just had great chemistry together. It floored me. It's ridiculous.
And J.K. is, I think, can do anything, but I didn't think of him as Sam Elliott until seeing this movie.
Yeah. I've said before, it takes a girl with daddy issues to see Whiplash and decide, you know, that guy's hot. We should make him a romantic lead. But, I've known his work forever. I've loved him since probably the first time I remember seeing him. I'm sure it was Oz, but I remember Thank You for Smoking and through Juno and, of course, you know, but... Yeah, when I saw Whiplash, I just thought, that's when I thought he can do anything. And I liked the idea that was sort of his, like, black hat cowboy, you know, and this would be his white hat cowboy. This would be, you know, the same kind of, like, what's that character like in Whiplash if he matured out of that anger, mellowed out at some point in life, and maybe regrets some things, and... So it was interesting to think of him as that, but
a lot of time in Maui would be
necessary. Yeah, I would say you need
sort of drug would be required.
Yeah, and then rehab. Yeah. Exactly.
Clean it up. So does mom meddle in the process of doing this, or did she?
Oh, that's thankfully no. I mean, I remember her being like, "Oh, don't have Susan wear glasses," and like, you know, like saying things like that because in her mind, this is just a fantasy all across the board. Mm-hmm. But no, I think she wasn't allowed on set because she thinks it was her idea, which is really cute. She's like, oh, I didn't want to get in Susan's way. And I'm like, yeah, we'll let you think that you decided that. But no, I didn't want Susan to feel uncomfortable at all, or like, especially because she really sucked the soul out of my mother to play this character.
Well, she says she still was a little freaked out. That was.
It's crazy. It's crazy how similar they. I mean, it, you know, it's bizarre how many even mannerisms she got. I mean, we had a 3-hour double date, Rose and Susan, and my mom and myself. I only kicked my mom under the table once, but yeah, no, it's it's surreal how many personal touches are in there. And but my mom, I think she's just, she can't believe this. You know, she feels like it's, what's so sweet is she doesn't even want to really think it's a movie about her. So she thinks of it as my father's It's a Wonderful Life, which is like the most heartbreaking thing, and so beautiful that she still thinks it's like his story as if he's gone. And but you know, every time she realizes, oh my gosh, that's something I said, or that is what I did, or that is, you know, what I think, that I think she gets very honored, you know, because I don't think in her wildest dreams that she would have thought there could be a movie about her, you know, without accomplishing unbelievable things or becoming a celebrity or famous for anything, and but being like a great mom and a great wife, and I think it's surreal for both of us.
And I noticed she's not in your press day today.
No, we did a photo shoot, though. We did our one photo shoot. We did one interview together, and I was nauseous when I left, so I don't know how many of those I'm going to do, you know. It's hard to calibrate exactly.
Sam Rubin has that effect on everybody. So
there you go.
Had nothing to do with your mother at all. Is she still living near the Grove?
No, she moved. She's closer to my house now. She's a mile down the road.
You were further, too far away.
We were too far. We'd have to meet at the Grove, and now, you know, she can just show right up at the front door with bagels. That's right on time. Yeah.
So, is it going to be hard to transition out of this degree of movie intimacy?
Maybe. I mean, honestly, it felt personal on the page, and my mom and I kind of dealt with it on the page years and years ago. And then, you know, you get all these actors and you just start making it, and it's work. It's a job. You're just trying to make a great movie. It kind of doesn't become personal anymore. Mm-hmm. Now it's so personal. It's so weird to share it with people and have people talk about the Marnie character and the Laurie character, or refer to it, you know, in a lighter way than I certainly felt it or something. I mean, that's strange, but I'm a fairly private person, so I look forward to actually, you know, not necessarily being an open book every day.
Well, theoretically, you could have not told anybody.
I know, but I just wanted to be, I wanted to tell her story, and it was impossible to be honest about, you know, not to be honest about my role in that. I mean, your mom see you at your worst, you know, and certainly when in grief, I was at my worst, and so I thought, shit, I have to say what I was actually like, and also say what she was like. But no, I mean, nothing's changed with my mom. She still calls all the time. I mean, it wasn't an attempt to, you know, do that, but it is an attempt in a way to, you know, give her this wish fulfillment, give her this love interest that doesn't exist in real life, give her some fun and adventure, and hopefully show other people that, you know, they can find the same happiness or hope, or, you know, that there's, with a lot of love to give, that you know, you good things will probably come back to you.
So this seems to be a moment in theatrical history where these kind of movies, and it's almost a genre now, of older people having these kind of adventures and discovery and everything else, and
who
doing
knew?
Quite well.
Yeah.
Do you think that's part of what finally got your movie made, besides just having Susan?
No, because at the time, I mean, we shot this a year ago, so no, at the time we didn't really have a lot of comparisons. It feels like it is truly within the last year, like Grandma, I'll See You in My Dreams, and Hello, My Name is Doris. I mean, yeah, it's bizarre, but it's also...
One of Susan's first movies with Blythe Danner, go figure.
Oh, wow, yeah. Well, she's gorgeous, too. I don't know what it is. I also have been sent, in the last 6 months, you know, potential scripts and things and ideas, that apparently female empowerment is a genre now. That's a new genre, which is exciting but also kind of strange, and that just in the last 6 months we've become empowered apparently, but it's
looking at abortion in Texas.
I don't know. Yeah, well, exactly. No, it's exciting to me that any human story gets told, because I think those are the movies that have been dying on the vine since, you know, whenever, the 90s. It feels like I like stories that handle the human condition and talk about characters and can be character studies and look inward and help people, you know, whatever, think, feel. I miss those movies, you know, and I miss the sort of tweeners that are now sent to television, because that's apparently where you're allowed to, you know, talk about humanity a little bit more. And of course, it's great, but I just miss those movies so much. I mean, I just miss like John Hughes, and I miss, I just miss character studies more than anything. And like, I know it's corny, I guess, but stories about good people going through really, really hard times. So it's messy and it's ugly and it's not easy, but that at the root of it, it's about people who care about each other. I've definitely written other kinds of scripts before, you know, that just happens to be the ones that have gotten made, you know, and have gotten going. And I'm grateful for that, because they're the scripts that are the truest to myself, you know.
So you've got those two things. You've got the movies that people aren't making anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've got being a woman.
Right.
Which one's harder?
Which one's
in more danger as a filmmaker?
I don't know. All the woman stuff is a real, it's a mixed bag, like it is every day of my life.
Do you feel it like that? Do you feel like a woman in filmmaking? Is that
not until it's always brought up, because right. I just walk around like myself, and I don't, you know, I mean, I identify with being an American almost as much, or a person from Jersey. I mean, you know, it feels like it's a shame that it's a word, like female filmmaker, female director. It's a shame that it's a, you know, this identifier that has to be used, when the only jobs that male get put in front of are nurse and model. You know, those are the two that you have to clarify. Those are guys. But no, it's what sucks is also it's not how I want to get a job, and I feel weird about that, because obviously I like that the doors are opening up more, that people are paying more attention, and certainly that writers' rooms are becoming more diverse. I think that's so important. But at the same time, when I get a call and it's like, you know, they were asking for you, and you're like, yeah, and they're like, yeah, they're looking for a female director. You're like, yeah, well, cool. Like, that's, like, knowing that that's what sent them to me is hard. But, you know, it was always like that. It's always been like this. I mean, as a writer, you get, you'll do a round table or a punch-up table or something, and a lot of times I would be the only woman in the room, and I'd be there specifically to help them with the female character. And other times you'd look around and it's all women, and and you're all there because they're trying to, you know, give this thing a female perspective or something. And it all feels very strange and condescending at the same time as you want people to pay more attention and open up the doors and be just more inclusive in general to women and people of color. But beyond, for me, it's beyond just the directors, the number of directors or writers or working producers. It's the stories themselves that I think are skewed, you know, and that's the part that's bummed me out the most, honestly, which is why I go back to movies of this kind, whether it's small independent character studies or movies about women or women of a certain age. And certainly now it feels like there's just a flood in the opposite direction, you know, but there was the year of Bridesmaids. That was supposed to be the year of women, you know, Mean Girls. I mean, there have been so many movies that they act like are going to turn the tides, and maybe now it finally will, because people are just pissed enough, you know, people finally just had it, it seems like. But for me, it's that I just want female characters to be treated like people the same way that I would like that to happen in life, and for all of this to just stop, you know? Like, I think it's so important that we talk about what makes us different, and yet more importantly to be able to just be part of the discussion and not have it be so divided, so that every panel I'm on isn't either all women, or every room I'm in I'm not the only woman. I mean, that if there could be a balance, that would be really nice.
I keep on saying women will finally have made it in Hollywood when they can make really bad movies.
Yeah.
It's the, it's it's the ability to just keep on making junk that is somehow a special male gift.
I'm sure we're making junk already. I'm sure that's there's happening. I mean, like, the, and plenty of bad movies by men, plenty of bad movies by everybody. Mediocrity's, you know, champion. But
that's
the
middle of the business. They always complain that guys can keep on getting jobs after bad movies, which women have done also. But it's just, as you say, the percentages are...
You do get in jail. Off. I do think you land in jail a little bit longer or quicker or something. That happens. But I don't really think that that's necessarily it. You know, when people ask me about the number of female directors, I had to think to myself, like, well, how many things haven't you turned down that some guy was like, yeah, I'll do that. You know, that I've read and thought, like, I can't put myself behind this. I can't spend the year and a half of my life on this, or I don't believe in what this says enough. You know, and I don't know whether that's a female thing or not. I just mean, I know I've done that. So it's not, what I'm the happiest about is that I felt like I had to claw my way back after Seeking a Friend. And I'm very happy that it was with something that I cared about even more rather than doing whatever it took to get back there, which, you know, you feel so desperate to try to, you know, get back in the fray and get back on set and everything. And instead of forcing it or doing a project I didn't believe in, you know, I really wanted to make this movie at all costs and kind of got rid of anyone in my path to make it and surrounded myself with helpful people who would help me do it. And that's something that may be a reason that there aren't less of us, but maybe, you know, we're choosier. I don't know. You know, it's again more about the women's stories just being allowed a certain spotlight and allowed a certain point of view. And yeah, like you said, like, make shitty movies, but also, like, have shitty characters, like, be a shitty person, be a, you know, because, I mean, I think a lot of times the unlikable character thing is often just assigned to female characters, you know, it feels like, it's often, I said, are you sure she's not going to be, like, too unlikable, and for both of these women, the mother can be super annoying, the daughter can be super bitchy, so, you know, it's obviously a balance, but it's also a reason why I was excited to try to explore that, because I do think that gets kind of, you know, washed over or pushed aside sometimes.
Well, at this moment, I think everything has moved so quickly.
Yeah.
Every conversation is, you know, black and white.
Yeah.
And so I think it's almost harder as women find their place. I mean, I think this industry needs to be seated more than it's seated, and people need to get more, you know, initial opportunities. But there are very few people who get movies are made that are new directors in any studio in any year.
Well, that's just
I think it's like 7 or 8 every year.
Right. And the people I know who are struggling to make it are, there's a lot of white guys. I'm just saying, like, a lot of the people that, you know, you assume are on top of and have the most opportunity, it's just hard to get a movie made. It's just hard to get a movie made. And so I recognize that. And you know, the same way that I could say, I think I don't know, maybe someone thought I was cute once and gave me a job. The same way that maybe someone thought, like, oh, don't give it to her, you know, she's whatever, she couldn't handle this. Or, you know, I think what's hard is when you're going up for financing. That might be the only time that I even feel like I'm a woman or that anything is happening. It's just because, you know, you kind of feel like you're talking to these older guys usually. You sort of feel like, oh, do they look at me and think I'm their ex-wife or their daughter asking them for money? You know, like, that's sort of the only time that you sort of feel like, have I shopped too much to be taken seriously? No, what I like about what you're saying, too, is that what's getting scary for me is a lot of, there's not as much of a dialogue anymore, it seems very like a very scary time to just talk about feminism, because as much as I think everybody should just, obviously there should be equal pay, obviously we should be treated equally, obviously we should have equal opportunity, then I think what past that, it's like if we could all just agree on that, then I would love for us to keep talking and learning from each other about what it is, because I'd hate to see a crop of angry young men, and I'd hate to feel like we're all just against each other in something. And, you know, of course that isn't what feminism is about, and, you know, that it's meant at its core to be inclusive, and it's meant for us to all feel like equal. Yeah. So I'd love for just more of a conversation. That's all. So I worry about us fighting so hard for certain things that we start to just, you know, not talk to each other, and yeah. You know, that can happen.
Well, you'd say they're victim or victimizer, which is bad.
Yeah.
And even
yeah.
though it's true, I mean, that's the thing. It's like, it's true, but it's also not true. It is, you know,
yeah.
most of the white men, most people not getting jobs are white men. However, they think, you know, the fact that you got your first movie at Warner Brothers means that you thought you could.
Oh, well, Warner Brothers, Warner Brothers was the first place to buy it. But yeah.
But, I mean, you thought you could do it, and yeah. that was a big part of you doing it. And I think most women who are, I mean, maybe it's changing generationally, but a lot of women just don't think it's an option, so they may not be trying to go there.
Maybe, but maybe most people didn't. I mean, when I was a kid, I didn't go to film school because but there weren't even screenwriting classes back then, you know, yeah. like it wasn't really a thing. And so maybe people are becoming just, in general, more aware of what's out there. And, you know, I have a group of friends that are such incredible screenwriters. Most of them, you know, others producers, and they're all incredibly successful and have put themselves out there and have been really brave and confident. And, you know, so I don't know, like, you know, what's hard is I'm surrounded. I might not have the right view because I'm surrounded by other women who are kind of just kicking ass. And so it's really exciting for all of us. We all certainly have our bad days or bad years or bad, mm-hmm. you know, bad choices and feel, you know, shitty about ourselves. But you know, it for me is, again, like the same way that I feel like I see a lot of guys trying to make it. I'm seeing a lot of girls making it. Of course, there is the opposite. Of course, there are mm-hmm. Men out there who are, you know, given opportunities and... It's, you know, when people ask me the disadvantages, I mean, the problem I find is that it's like I'm a woman, so, like, yeah, I'll bond with Susan, you know? Like, she and I, we have bonded, and mm-hmm. we have, like, this weird mother-daughter kind of thing because of everything. And so, you know, like, yeah, there are other occasions where it's like, oh, God, well, I'm an unmarried woman. I don't have kids. You know, how close can I get with this actor without, you know, you just, there are moments like that where it's mm-hmm. just the same as just everyday life. You know, it really just isn't that different. And so, you know, you just, those are the ways to navigate it, but it's not that strange just because I, you know, I'm just myself. So I walk around like this all day. So it's not too different on a set.
Well, you're doing very well in it.
Oh, well, thanks. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Nice to meet you.